Our industry is a place of inspiration. That's why I love bringing together CGA Belgrade and meeting exquisite people. Thanks to our partners and industry sponsors, we get to host the latest technologies. But more than that, we host people who know the industry from the inside out, but their curiosity always breaks into new realms. It is my great honor to wish a warm welcome to a virtual production guru, Connie Kennedy from the EPIC Los Angeles Lab, and production associate Lara for joining us today. Hello, Connie and Lara. Wow, you are at your lab. It looks awesome.
Thank you. Welcome to the Los Angeles Innovation Lab for Epic Games.
Wow.
Our lab was built about 1 year ago, and since then, we've been a hub for the community in Los Angeles. We built our stage with the latest Roe BP2 version 2 panels, megapixel processors. We've included a ceiling with the same panels, and we've incorporated a number of different types of hardware through our partners. We have an Arri Mini LF picture camera, a Sony Venice, and we also have practical lighting that Arri has donated for use on the stage. We're also working with Sony. Sony has provided our monitors, and we have a brain bar with 5 different mobile workstations. And so our stage is focused on testing and developing the tools for virtual production. What we're doing on the stage is we're trying to help people work in engine as much as possible. And those tools that we're creating are something that are constantly in development and being deployed to the community. And Lara is here with me today to talk a little bit about the testing that we're doing specifically.
Thanks, Connie. We do use the stage both for interaction with the community, which we love to do, but we're also using it as an internal R&D facility. So all of the releases that you see come out, we're working hard to make sure that things are always a step above the last release. We're making the tools for filmmakers better, stronger for stage, more reliable. So that's where a lot of the brains trust works here, and we work with teams from all over the world, some of the brightest minds in this area, to really make sure that virtual production is what it is today and can get better in the future.
Thank you, ladies. Connie, you can start with your presentation now.
Good morning. My name is Connie Kennedy. I'm the director of the Los Angeles Innovation Lab for Epic Games. It's a pleasure to be here today. It's an exciting time to be working in entertainment. Real-time production is rapidly changing the way we create and share content. We're now using game engines for film and television production, and we're pioneering new workflows and roles, building new collaborative tools, and creating new opportunities for storytelling. The lines are blurring as the assets are being leveraged and used across different types of content. As this technology becomes even more advanced, anyone, anywhere will have the power to create photorealistic animation and 3D visualization instantaneously. Entire industries and economies are being revolutionized as a result. With this shift, the film and television industry is moving rapidly towards a new era of real-time production. A great example of this is seen in my first video, which shows the way in which the film production company Final Pixel has integrated the latest in-camera visual effects into their production workflow. Let's take a look.
Unreal Engine is the most powerful 3D content tool on the planet. It allows us to create realistic environments and place our actors in a virtual set.
Virtual production allows you to do these incredible real-time composites live on stage without using green screen. We create photoreal 3D models and then we play them on a giant curved LED wall.
It renders in real time, which means there is no lag, no delay. You put your 3D model on screen in front of the camera, and you can move around in that environment, and all of the lighting reacts to changes in our scene.
When the camera moves in 3D space, the image on the wall also moves in 3D, and the perspective changes, and that's what creates an incredibly realistic illusion.
From a DP's perspective, lighting, I get to see natural light, natural colour, everything that's affecting the environment, actually seeing that on telling themselves.
So much flexibility for a director or a director of photography to make adjustments. If we want to change the time of day or if we want to light certain parts of the scene differently, we can do that immediately without having to wait for it to render.
The real-time lighting changes that occur in camera, it's so much more organic compared to a green screen.
Virtual production is bringing a whole new department to the film set. It's the software developers, the programmers, as well as the 3D modelers and the technical artists.
One of the real tricks to virtual production is the ability to blend a physical set with a virtual set. You have to be able to create a believable, practical foreground set that merges seamlessly with the 3D image, the 3D environment on the wall. This is a very powerful medium for actors because unlike green screen, they can see the environment that they're in, and that seems to really elevate their performance.
From the second we arrived on set, you can actually see, oh, this is the tone of the piece. You get to see the effects straight away as a performer.
We took previous projects from our portfolio to see if we could recreate them in virtual production and solve some problems for our clients. It turns out the 3D modeling process is just as good as filming in a real location.
And what's great about the 3D modeling process is that clients can decide exactly what they want in the set in advance of the shoot. Without having to spend weeks doing location searches, you can specify exactly what you want, and that's an incredibly powerful part of virtual production.
The really great advantage is having on-set final pixel shots, so that when you've got it and you go into the edit, it's done.
The technology is really exciting. So many advances in film and TV have converged at the same point to really bring the magic back into filmmaking.
As a filmmaker, virtual production is giving us a whole new set of tools with which we can push back the boundaries of film and television, and that's incredibly exciting.
As you just saw with Final Pixel, film production companies are successfully implementing new real-time tools. These tools and the development of in-camera visual effects could not have come at a better time. The restrictions that were implemented during the pandemic forced the acceleration and development of all aspects of virtual production. The need for localized and remote capabilities on set has led to quick adoption of virtual production technology. Additionally, these same forces have pushed the development of many new tools for content display and interactive filmmaking, namely the use of LED walls and volumetric capture. The most recognized example of this type of production, of course, is The Mandalorian, which began as a collaboration with Lucasfilm and Epic Games. Since then, a number of ambitious projects have pushed the technology to the next level. In-camera visual effects creates a more immersive experience for the actors, making the performance more realistic and believable. Additionally, these new tools for production design and previs lead to a more efficient and strategic decision-making process. This allows for more control over the budget decisions and creative choices. As a result, asset creation can happen prior to on-set production, limiting the need for costly changes after filming is completed. The choice to use in-camera visual effects can have huge potential benefits, facilitating a more immersive and inspired filmmaking experience. However, the complexity of this type of shoot means that the pre-visualization is a crucial step towards reducing risk. The next video featuring the third floor does a great job showcasing some of the latest real-time tools and game engine technology. This has successfully moved Previs to the next level. Let's take a look at their presentation from this year's Unreal Virtual Production Week.
Hi, I'm Johnson Thomason, Virtual Production Developer and Unreal Engine Enthusiast. On behalf of the third floor, I want to thank you for checking us out at Unreal Virtual Production Week. The third floor is the premier provider of visualization services for film and TV, as well as themed entertainment. We've been supporting productions for over 16 years. We're an increasingly global company with headquarters in Los Angeles, London, Beijing, and I'm here at our newest official branch in Atlanta, Georgia. We're on the lot at Trillith Studios, a world-class production facility where third floor teams have collaborated over the years on shows like Ant-Man, Avengers Endgame, The Tomorrow War, and many others. We've recently announced an alliance with the Imaginarium Studios here at this location. Lots of exciting things to come here. We're thrilled to be on the lot in the Creative Core. Now, let me tell you about how we utilize virtual production techniques in the Unreal Engine to deliver best-in-class visualization services. Creative decision makers can scout their worlds and shots in VR. On HBO's Game of Thrones, we developed a virtual reality scouting toolset that uses Unreal to support the art department. It's a system to explore proposed designs and actors, creature, prop, and camera placements before the constructed sets exist. For Sony's Venom, Let There Be Carnage, this scouting system enabled virtual walkthroughs of production designs and CG set extensions for the movie's prison and cathedral scenes. The film team could use this tech to gauge the space needed for character action in the prison breakout and develop modular shooting options and resets for two-way filming that extended distance on the practical stage. For the church standoff, we created an explorable cathedral asset based on art department models, showing both the real C stage and CG set extensions for the vaulted ceiling and interior tower. Scale and aesthetics of these real-world and digital set elements, as well as scaffold dressings, could be planned through views in VR. Where visualization once served exclusively as an early phase step, it is now used to help fuel the entire filmmaking process. As the complexity of today's projects increases, so does the need to maintain context, keeping all departments aware of how their work is building towards the finished film. Sophisticated LED volume productions like The Mandalorian extensively rely on careful planning to maximize the creative potential. Our internal R&D department is always looking ahead. Here you can see some behind-the-scenes footage of a test from a few years ago. We're mixing simulcam and interactive lighting. The tracked picture camera is driving a virtual camera in Unreal, which is rendered and composited into the background in real time. It's also driving a second virtual camera up in the sky that is capturing a shadow map of the tree canopy, displayed through projectors and RE Sky panels. All of the interaction was live and driven through Unreal Engine. We love projects that have interesting and specific needs like this. Often the same basic proven processes can be combined in a new way to solve new creative challenges. Visualization in Unreal Engine offers faster ways to communicate the creative vision throughout the filmmaking process, helping today's visionaries realize ideas and move the industry forward. Thanks for spending your time with the third floor today at Unreal Virtual Production Week.
These same iterative capabilities that are part of Previs are now also available in real-time production. Filmmakers are continually pushing the boundaries, always looking for new ways to tell stories. For example, at the start of the pandemic, the new television series Star Trek Discovery was forced into lockdown. Like many companies at the time, all production was moved to remote work. The Star Trek team quickly pivoted and installed an LED volume in time to begin filming their upcoming fourth season. The result was what they called the AR wall, which uses Unreal Engine technology to track large-scale virtual locations. Another project that nearly shut down due to the pandemic was the Netflix series 1899, which was shot in Babelsberg, Germany earlier this year. The team decided to take a chance and try real-time production, using a huge LED volume to film a ship at high seas. The production team had no previous experience with this type of shoot. As their plans evolved, changes and challenges, along with set changes and camera angles, led to the idea of building a revolving stage inside the LED volume. This meant the stage could be dressed for multiple scenes and then moved into position for each set change, making it possible to shoot multiple physical and digital sets in a single day. In an effort to pre-plan the scenes in advance, a digital twin of the volume was developed in Unreal Engine. This helped the art department determine what to build practically and what could be built as a digital set extension. And as if that wasn't enough of a challenge, the team also successfully managed to add real rain, wind, and waves. In this next video, let's take a look at their journey.
Hi, my name is Jantje. I'm the showrunner and head writer of Dark. Of Dark.
Hi, I'm Baran Bo-Uda. I'm the showrunner, director and executive producer of 1899. Dark was not about action at all, but this is really an action show with a lot of violence, beating, running, screaming. Someone at Netflix told us about the volume technology. To be honest, after three seasons of Dark, we were a bit tired of doing it in a very traditional way. Netflix was super helpful from the beginning because they said this might be the future and could be really interesting for your project.
How would you describe the volume to somebody who knows nothing about it?
I tried to describe it to my son and I just said, oh.
It's like the biggest TV you'll ever see. And we just act in front of it.
It looks real. It really looks real. And that, of course, it's a huge help for us. So we don't have to travel to the desert, nor to the North Pole, nor to the glaciers and stuff. You can change that within a minute.
It would be a totally different experience if we're doing this on green screen. It just illuminates, like, literally everything. You see the whole landscape in front of you and the lighting. And so you're really looking at the sea.
It's a lot of prep work. It is a lot of frustration at the beginning because it is literally a new way of filmmaking.
We get to be pioneers. We get to work on things we have no idea about.
I think it's gonna be exciting to watch if the audience actually loves this new puzzle too, as they liked Dark, and if they will figure out what this show is actually really about.
This overview of the projects using real-time production would not be complete without including the recent TV series called Our Flag Means Death. The content for this project was created using high-resolution images of the ocean, which were then displayed on a massive 60 by 130-foot LED volume. The plate photography was streamed to the LED wall to simulate the open sea as a backdrop for the romantic comedy featuring Rhys Darby and Taika Waititi. Stargate Studios created the plates for playback using a customized 8-camera rig to capture the images. This content was then stitched and fed into Unreal Engine for camera tracking and distribution to a 20K LED wall. Lighting from the LED panels was used to recreate the way sunlight hits the open water, creating the overall look of the picture. The size and shape of the volume provided multiple camera angles that would have been far more challenging and more cost prohibitive on location. The result was quite impressive. Let's have a look.
Here we are on the set of The Revenge, a great new show Our Flag Means Death from HBO Max. And what's unique about this show is that we are in a virtual ocean.
We're gonna go on up there and we're gonna cause some havoc.
How violent do we expect this to get?
Note the gusto!
Mind you taking notes?
If you're gonna do anything like this, it's really important to have pre-production time to shoot your plates, design the set properly, integrate the lighting, test the look, the colorimetry of the screen versus your camera versus your lenses. All those things play into the finished look because you are creating the finished look live on set. We started working very early on testing curved screens at our facility downtown and all the different combinations we could think of. So we shot plates here locally and we tested grain, resolution, curve of the screen, ambient bounce light, everything we could think of to really put it through its paces before we got on set.
This is one of those shows that took a long time to get created because of the physical challenges and not being able to shoot actually on the seas. So finally, the technology was just starting to get to the point when you could do this type of thing in real time directly on the Warner Brothers lot. And it really made this show possible.
We're swashbuckling, we're looting. Let's have fun with it.
Come on.
6 weeks before the show, we went to Puerto Rico and started shooting. We shot a lot of water. Boats with multiple rigs from the shore at multiple times of day. Everything we could think of, day, night, magic hour, inclement weather, sunny weather, all of it, to build a library for the show. What allowed us to do such a high resolution wall with everything at full res, full 20K, was shooting with multiple cameras at 12, so we shot with five Blackmagic 12Ks for a total of 60K horizontal resolution in the original photography. And then we brought that to Stargate, stitched it all together, which is quite a job, and split it up into 8K quadrants, put that back through the 8K deck links and resolves, multiple resolves, for full color control on set, full focus control on set, which we have to have. The end result is a full 20K, 160-foot wall that you can look wherever you want with multiple cameras and shoot like you would shoot a comedy, which is long takes, multiple cameras, steady cam, anywhere you look, you can shoot. So it's extremely real.
A lot of the guys are sweethearts deep down.
Well, that's perfect.
They're just dealing with a fair amount of trauma.
What makes Stargate different is that we have a history in camera, in 2D, and that's the way that we approach most of these projects. It's how can this be a photographic result? Not something that's built in a game engine and it may look a little gamey or it needs to be finessed. It's how can we take what is real, literally out there on the sea or out there on some vista or the forest. It is a photographic plate. How can we bring that plate to the set? And that's something that Stargate excels in.
We have a full-size pirate ship that breaks into three pieces designed by Rob Vincent. Fabulous piece of design. So we worked very close in pre-production with Rob to design a volume that would fit the pirate ship Revenge. And then decided to put the ship on wheels so we could wheel it in and out and create different ships. The English warship and the French warship and all the other ships had to be made out of this ship. So it's a very flexible, modular design on not only the physical set, but the LED volume itself and the lighting.
Floggings, keel haulings, and my thought is, why? And also, what if it works like that?
Shy as a shadow, lovely as lace and cold as... The reason we chose virtual production for the solution here is we had done some great work with HBO on Run, where we spent 12 weeks on a train with virtual production. And it was, when you were on that train, it was real. And here we're 14 weeks on a soundstage on ships and islands. And you know, you don't want to be there for that long on green screen. So I think it's a much better experience for actors and directing and camera, because it's in camera. It's a director of photography medium, because you're literally taking what we used to do in post-production, color timing, depth of field, all those things can be done now live on set.
Stargate was fortunate enough on this show and most of our shows to be in charge of content and the on-set playback. So having the knowledge of how one interacts with the other and how to optimize and how to handle media and how to just manage the entire process really situates Stargate toward success on future shows.
It's a wonderful illusion, and I think it brings the magic back to filmmaking in a real-time sense and gets everyone involved, and we're really proud to be part of it.
These new production tools have benefited all of the projects we've just seen. However, while in-camera visual effects has rapidly become one of the most promising techniques in media, replacing green screen and solving many problems, it also creates new ones. Work traditionally left to post-production is now allocated to pre-production. So this means that the investments, actors, and locations will all need to be lined up much earlier in the process. Additionally, there's a significant lack of trained resources, but this problem is only temporary. At Epic, we've been working with partners to develop educational courses such as the ICVFX Fellowship and other initiatives to help schools scale and improve their own curriculum. As more projects begin to integrate the new workflow, these challenges will become less significant. But film and television production is just one side of the story. Just as movies are rapidly incorporating real-time game technology, video games are also quickly incorporating cinematic elements from movies. Games are now utilizing astoundingly realistic graphics. They incorporate complex open worlds and nuanced narratives that rival those of film and television. Game developers have consistently invested in content and R&D, and that investment has now benefited other industries. Recently, Epic introduced Unreal Engine 5. Which will change nearly every aspect of the production process. This has led to an exciting convergence of pipelines, production tools, and new workflows. A great example is in this next video, an interactive tech demo produced by Epic Games earlier this year to showcase the new features of Unreal Engine 5. It's a wild ride into the reality-bending universe of The Matrix. Let's listen to Epic's CTO, Kim Labrary.
I joined Epic because I've always believed that real-time technology has the power to revolutionize the creative process across all industries. Being able to make instantaneous decisions within a near photoreal interactive environment is utterly transformative. It empowers you to make big changes to a scene and see them immediately in context. This is a better, quicker, and much more efficient way of creating content. It's been fantastic to see our customers using the engine in so many different ways, from indie creative projects all the way up to AAA games and even movies. But for us to really be sure that Unreal Engine 5 has achieved the goals we set for it, to really change the way interactive and linear media is made, we needed to push the engine to a new extreme. And that's how the Matrix Awakens demo came about.
How do we know what is real?
I was fortunate enough to have worked on the first three Matrix movies at a time when visual effects was revolutionizing the movie business. Having the opportunity to work on another Matrix project and push technology yet again was really special, It was a privilege for us to bring the Matrix universe to a whole new generation of viewers and players. We wanted to show that high-end visuals at a massive scale were possible in a living, breathing, and believable open world. And we wanted to show that a player could be immersed in an exciting cinematic scene that would normally only be possible in a blockbuster film. What's been fantastic is seeing how a fully interactive set can change the process of filmmaking. In what can be described as life imitating art, we actually filmed the cinematic sections of the demo inside the Matrix city we had built, where our artists would drive cars, set up stunts, and place pyrotechnics all inside a fully simulated world. And because this is a simulation that can be recorded by Unreal, we can then place optimal cameras in the scene after the fact to give maximum cinematic impact. Unreal Engine 5 isn't just about making existing ways of doing things faster. It's about finding whole new approaches to transform the way content is made and experienced. Nanite micropolygon geometry allows for billions of triangles on the screen at any moment, and Luma's real-time global illumination enables highly realistic lighting. They combine together to generate real-time content at a level that would have seemed like magic only a few years ago. For the building of the Matrix megacity, we didn't have a huge environment team, so we had to build it in a really smart and efficient way. We wanted to create a large-scale city with fidelity and complexity beyond what is typical in an open-world game. And for this, we deployed procedural content creation techniques, including partnering with our friends at SideFX to use Houdini and Houdini Engine. Developer efficiency is a recurring theme that goes beyond Unreal Engine and into our other products. MetaHuman Creator and Quixel Megascans show how we're enabling creators to make very high-quality content more quickly than ever before. Pulling together the city for The Matrix Awakens and bringing it to life would have been impossible without these tools. Unreal Engine is revolutionizing how creators tell stories and how people experience them, enabling developers to leverage one set of assets for whatever type of content they can dream up, from games to linear animation, and even to live-action shows and movies. One of the most important aspects of creating The Matrix Awakens demo was our commitment to release the city as a sample content. We want to show in a step-by-step manner how we created this world together and to provide a starting point for others to make their own worlds, tell stories, even build new games on top of this incredible digital city. Unreal Engine 5 is the foundation of next-gen content creation. So what are you waiting for? Go make something amazing.
I think we just saw the future. The possibilities are endless. But with all real-time production, content is key. Quality content is the difference between a good production and a great production. In an effort to help level up content for all creatives, Epic has assembled an ecosystem of the best artists and content developers in the world. Their work will help to build the best platform for all types of uses. As a community of artists, we need the tools, the best tools, to create compelling virtual worlds across all types of consumer hardware. This process is quickly becoming more automated and efficient. With these new tools, we're now moving film quality assets into real-time production for a variety of cross-media projects. The next generation of virtual content should enable photorealism to move closer and closer to what the eye can see in real life. Democratization of content is also crucial. Developing ways to recycle and repurpose assets will unlock new possibilities for storytelling. In this next video, Jerome Chen describes what he calls the sandbox, where artists at Sony Imageworks created photorealistic human characters for the TV series Love, Death, and Robots. Let's take a look at the ways in which the team was able to push the boundaries of what is possible.
What was really exciting about Love, Death, and Robots was basically Tim Miller, the producer, was creating a sandbox for animators to explore creatively without trying to fit into a franchise or fit into a particular audience. He basically picks all the short stories, and then you're allowed to run with quite a bit of freedom within that framework. And that was obviously really exciting for us. In Vaulted Halls Entombed, it's a military story. Basically, soldiers meet creature and have to fight for their lives.
So Doug Ottey approached me and said, we're going to do this thing. It's got Cthulhu in it. And I said, I'm in. And then he said, photorealistic humans, multitudes of swarming, flesh-eating insects. And he said, we're going to do it in Unreal Engine. And I said, I don't know what that is, so let's get into it. Let's try it out.
I've been intrigued by real-time filmmaking for many, many years, even prior to the advent of Unreal and other types of technology like that. And I was looking for an opportunity to do something creative using real-time. I saw the episode for LDR as a perfect opportunity, even though we had no prior footprint for Unreal at the company. It was a leap of faith. It's gonna be hard, there's no roadmap, there's probably no parachute. I love those kind of challenges. I love going into a project where you may not know how you're gonna do it. You have to have enough confidence and maybe enough self-delusion. If you get to work on something like this once in your career, I mean, you're lucky. What I found to be really exciting about this workflow is the fact that in pre-production, when you're building assets that you're gonna be using in layout, those are the same assets that are gonna end up in the final piece. They just get progressively better through the process.
We built an entire 15-minute piece as a framework to work from within 2 weeks. Next step would be to take that up and sort of raise the level of the entire piece all at the same time, right up until the shoot.
We were showing blocking. We actually got feedback from the clients. They're like, did you spend all your rendering budget on your assets already?
Working inside of Unreal flips the script a little bit. Our asset artists become world builders, and they are able to pick and choose from the Quixel library or other libraries that we have available. The fidelity that's available to you at the click of a button, it's incredible, it's amazing. And it allows ideas to happen organically, and you can explore.
You're just not focused on turntables anymore. You're seeing things live in the shots as they are meant to be. And you get swept up in the story, you get swept up in the capacity to change it and shape it. It's pretty liberating.
The performance capture process, we prepared Unreal assets that could be played on monitors, tracked with the camera in real time, where then the actors could then see themselves in the body of their avatars. And then they would know as they're walking through a tunnel, for instance, the curve of the tunnel, they actually will maybe crane their head and kind of peek around a corner. But on the set, what they're really seeing is just a bunch of poles indicating the volume of the tunnel. And that's vital for helping performances. Usually, it takes a week or so before I can get the data. I have to actually order the data and be very specific about which takes I like so that they can process the body motion capture first so that we can begin the process of doing layout.
Normally, we try to make our first edit with cuts from the video footage, which is this mix of 2D storyboards and video footage of actors running around on a soundstage with tights. And it feels a million miles away from what your project is going to look like. With Unreal's involvement, you get the take recorder clips almost right away. You've got characters interacting in your environment, and you can place cameras on them. You get the eye lines figured out or what your cutting pattern looks like. And that's going to inform how you make your mocap selects. Now you're making your cut with footage that looks like the footage in the final project.
We can't say enough about MetaHumans. The project was very ambitious. It was doing 6 characters, human photorealistic characters in engine for 15 minutes short, all of them with dialogue, many of them with various degrees of mutilation and complexity.
In our early discussions with Epic, they showed me an early version of the MetaHuman demo, which was basically almost pre-beta code. It was super impressive.
Definitely one of the most time-consuming and resource-intensive things we do is build face rigs. They're incredibly resource-heavy, lots of iterations. There's a ton of bespoke work involved in that. So when we knew we had the prospect of MetaHuman, we thought, yeah, let's lean on these guys and see what they can deliver for us. We ended up using them for 3 of our 6 human characters that have face rigs. And the rigs are as powerful as any rigs we're using right now.
You know, it's a real game changer. It is something that allows you to not worry about the details of that aspect of it, and you can focus on the storytelling.
Real-time technology has started to blur the lines between what was otherwise weeks and months of rendering to get to final product. Once you've got your environments laid out, your sets are lit, everything is looking good, your performances are in there, the animation's in there, you can rework the entire film in a day or two, like every shot.
When you get used to doing real-time decision-making, the quality of the work is always better. So that edge that the engine gives you is incalculable. It's easy for me to say that I don't want to go back.
As we have just seen, it's often visionaries like Jerome Chen and Sam Nicholson, or companies like Pixamondo, ILM, and Weta, who believe in their team and seize the moment when the technology is ready for production. That moment is one that is manifested around collaboration and shared experience. I think we would all agree that there's a greater need than ever before for community around the development of resources for all types of media and entertainment. We need to work together to collectively create and share compelling real-time content. There are limitless possibilities that immersive and interactive technology are bringing to all aspects of commerce and culture. This will require the best tools, the best services, giving artists the freedom to create in better ways, as well as enabling inclusion and participation for everyone, wherever they live. Community is at the core of Epic's lab in Los Angeles. It's our goal at the lab to demonstrate the use of these new tools and to help explore various customized pipeline solutions for their projects. Workshops, fellowships, demo presentations, events, R&D, and testing are all part of the upcoming agenda for the lab. We're constantly pushing the boundaries of what's possible, looking for solutions to share with our partners. All of these experiences, which we're building together, are not likely to stay fragmented. At some point, the advantages to companies and consumers of connecting them will become too obvious. It's then that we will find ourselves in a real metaverse, where we can explore a new path to market using new distribution models, designing affordable and accessible tools, creating reusable content, and developing a shared, vibrant ecosystem. This path we're on towards a shared open experience will present new job opportunities. The demand for skilled animators is higher than ever. This is a great time to be working with real-time tools, which can be applied in new and vast ways across all industries. And that concludes our introduction. We look forward to meeting many of you and continuing the conversation. Thank you.
Thank you, Connie, very much for your great presentation. It was really inspiring. What really strikes me is looking at all these different studios and how agile they are into, regrouping and fastly moving throughout the, the new circumstances that occurred during the last 2 years in pandemic. So have you witnessed some other changes in the way the production work, given the fact that we were staying at home and couldn't move so easily as we did before?
I think what we've done that has been truly effective is the ability to allow people to remote into our stage and work together collaboratively, regardless of where they live and what type of equipment they have at home. They're able to innovate in ways that allow us to continue running our stage, even though we can't have everyone physically here. We've also set up testing for COVID, and we've used masks, and it's given us the ability to continue to work on the stage regardless of the pandemic. We've also brought in the community in different ways by helping them to be a part of our events safely by testing for COVID, and we've been able to continue running the stage regardless of that.
Thank you very much. And I have one more question for you. Given the fact that I run Creative Training Center, and during this summer we actually had a virtual production lab, we call it the Virtual Environments Lab, and we gathered newcomers in the industry to do virtual sets. And I just wanted to say how, in a way, happy we are that EPIC provided for all of us that want to learn and train a lot of content and free tools to start with. And that is something really inspiring that your company is doing. So I would like also to know, regarding education, what are the other efforts that you are involved with, and the other things and initiatives that you are taking?
The stage team has been directly involved in education initiatives at EPIC. We've been hosting the latest fellowship for ICBFX specifically. We've also got a new program that's coming up for world building that will be later this year. And we've continued with ICBFX fellowships throughout the last year and a half. So we've been very active in helping to create a curriculum that's being deployed to all universities around the world. I think everyone throughout the world is in, they're looking for resources to run their stages, and that's something that we're trying to facilitate as best we can.
Yes, that's a really great thing, because the demand for Unreal Engine artists is really huge in the world, and it is so in Serbia as well. So it's a great thing to have so many resources for learning. And I would just like one more question for Laura. Do you have maybe any advice for people that are entering the industry, for young people? Would you recommend them this kind of industry, so working on virtual sets and whatever is in your, you know, like day-to-day job, you know, like description? So how would you advise them?
My first step would be to go on and learn Unreal. I come from a film background like Connie, and for young film crews or students who are studying, that's my first tip to everyone at the moment, because the versatility of the Unreal Engine is going to continue to spread throughout the community as we continue to make films and push boundaries. So that's definitely my first tip. If I'm sure most people are aware, but we've got an extensive amount of free online education that people can access, and they can work through their own, you know, tailor their education as per their interests. So if they're more into game side, or if they're more into virtual art department, you can really tailor the way that you learn the engine. And I truly think that it's just another amazing set of tools that's going to really allow us to push the way that we make content in the future, in whatever form that takes. So my number one to any student, whatever department they're intending on being in, is always learn the Unreal Engine, and then you can basically carve out a path for yourself going forward after that.
Wow, that's really great advice. Thank you very much. And thank you, ladies, for joining us today at the CGA conference. Wishing you a good rest of the day, and hopefully we will meet again at some other occasion.
We hope so.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you very much. Bye.
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 Thank you very much.